Hello students, my hearty welcome once again. On this session, we are going to discuss the topic treatment of goodwill on the admission of a new partner. A quick recap on the meaning of goodwill. Goodwill represents the reputation of any business unit which can be expressed in terms of money. In fact, it represents the future profit earning capacity of any business unit. Now, all of you know very well that in case if a new person is admitted in the partnership firm, the existing partners may have to sacrifice a portion of their profits in order to accommodate the upcoming partner. And for this reason, that the new partner has to bring a certain premium, that is any money which is up and above their capital investment, in order to compensate the sacrifice or the loss sustained by the existing partners foregoing their profits. So this is what we term to be goodwill. Naturally, we understand that goodwill is the premium money brought in by the new partner, which will be shared among the existing partners. So here in this particular lecture, we are going to discuss on the accounting treatment in respect to goodwill at the time of admission of a new partner. Now I have chosen four different situations of how goodwill could be treated. Again, this list is not exhaustive by itself, and we have different other methods of the treatment of goodwill. At present, we are going to discuss four significant ways of the treatment of goodwill in respect to admission of a new partner. The first one being goodwill brought in the form of cash. The new partner brings goodwill in the form of cash, and this money has to remain in the business. Retained, meaning it needs to remain in the business. The second situation would be goodwill brought in the form of cash again, but the old partners would be allowed to withdraw this money which has been brought by the new partner in the form of cash. The situation next would be goodwill raised. No fresh money will be brought in by the new partner, but this goodwill money will be raised in the business and would be retained. And the last situation under our discussion would be again goodwill being raised, but this time it needs to be written off, meaning it should be removed from the books of the accounts. So we will discuss these four significant situations on the treatment of goodwill. Let's see one by one. As we proceed, the first situation stands like this. Goodwill brought in cash by the new partner and to be retained in the business. Again here, two things happen. Visualize when I am saying you this. Just visualize. Goodwill brought in cash by the new partner. So when cash comes into the business and it is in the form of goodwill, goodwill being an asset is being given by the new partner. So naturally, what would be the journal entry to be drafted? Here it would be cash coming into the business, which needs to be debited. Debit what comes in. So naturally, cash or bank account to be debited. To goodwill account, that is the new person, the new partner's goodwill account has to be credited because the new partner is the giver of the benefit. So here the journal entry would read like this: cash or bank account debit to goodwill account, being the goodwill brought in the form of cash. Now we know that this goodwill, which is to be brought in by the new partner, belongs to the old partners, the existing partners, and it needs to be shared among the existing partners. So when you share this goodwill, goodwill account debit to old partner's capital account. So when you are distributing this goodwill to the existing partners, The journal entry to be drafted would be goodwill account debit to old partner's capital account. And remember, students, when we are distributing this cash which is brought in the form of goodwill, it needs to be distributed among the old partners in their sacrifice ratio. In case if the sacrifice ratio details are not given in the question, the old ratio should be considered as the sacrifice ratio. To proceed further, see here, this is the second situation we are going to discuss right now. Goodwill is again brought in the form of cash by the new partner, but this time this cash is to be shared among the old partners. So we are going to allow the old partners to take away this goodwill home. That is what we mean by withdrawal of this goodwill by the old partners. In this case, first the cash comes into the business. Of course, we distribute that goodwill among the old partners, but in addition to that, there will be furthermore one more journal entry wherein we allow the old partners to withdraw this goodwill. So here the first two entries are similar to that of the previous situation. The first being cash or bank account debit to goodwill account. This is the entry that we pass when the new partner brings goodwill in the form of cash. And whether said expressly or not, we understand that this goodwill brought in by the new partner has to be shared among the old partners, for which the journal entry would be goodwill account debit to old partner's capital account. So the goodwill has to be distributed among the old partners. Now there will be one additional journal entry, students, for the withdrawal of goodwill by the old partners. What do we mean by withdrawal here? Taking home their share of goodwill. So here, when the old partners are withdrawing the goodwill from the business, money goes out of the business. So credit what goes out. And who is at the receiving end? Old partners. So the journal entry would be old partners capital account debtor to cash or bank account being goodwill withdrawn by the old partners. I hope you would have understood these two situations, and we will move into the third situation now. The third situation is goodwill is raised. No money comes in. It is only created. Raised meaning it is created in the business and is kept in the business in a separate account called goodwill account. So goodwill is raised and has to be retained in the business. So the journal entry for the goodwill being raised: goodwill account debtor to old partners' capital accounts. So here this goodwill which is being raised is distributed among the old partners. Usually an old ratio is to be observed in the distribution. Now remember, I told you this goodwill being raised is to be retained in the business. So you still have money in the goodwill account, which represents an asset account. So naturally, the debit balance of the goodwill will be shown on the asset side of the new balance sheet. The new balance sheet represents the balance sheet which needs to be drafted after the admission of the partner. So in that new balance sheet, on the asset side, goodwill will be shown as an intangible asset. Well, the last situation under our discussion is goodwill raised and written off. The meaning of written off is again like we are going to distribute this goodwill to the personal accounts of the partners. Though it remains in the business, then it is again given away to the personal accounts of the partners. The first entry for raising the goodwill will be similar to that of the previous situation: goodwill account debit to old partners' capital account. So when the goodwill amount is raised in the business, it needs to be shared among the old partners in the old ratio. So for which goodwill account debit to old partners capital account, being goodwill distributed among the old partners. For writing off the goodwill, again you may have to debit all the partners account in case if this writing off happens after admission. See students, attentively listen to this fact that there are two ways of writing off the goodwill that has been raised in the business. One is to the old partners, the other way is generally to all the partners including the new partner. So in case if you are writing off goodwill to all the partners including the new partner, the entry would be all partners capital account debit to goodwill account. Generally, practically speaking, goodwill will be written off to all the partners even including the new partner. And naturally, we will be following the new profit sharing ratio when we are writing off the goodwill to all the partners capital account. Now here comes a new concept called the preparation of revaluation account. Let me at the outset tell you the necessity for the preparation of the revaluation account, then we will discuss its meaning and the method of preparation. See, actually, you know that according to historical cost concept, what happens is any asset that is being recorded into the books of the accounts will be recorded at their purchase price. Now, the asset would have been purchased many years ago. So, when you were purchasing an asset, the cost price would have been very less. Now, on this date, say maybe after 10 years or after 5 years, when you are admitting a new partner, remember, after admission, the new partner also has an equivalent share in the asset value of the firm. In such a case, what happens is, unless and until the present value of the asset is being recorded, the old partners would be under loss if the books of the accounts are not being changed. Take an example. In case if the buildings were worth 10 lakh rupees at the time of purchase 5 years ago, and today the same building is worth 20 lakh rupees. So, but the books of accounts are showing the building's worth is still 10 lakhs because we are not going to alter the value of any asset since we follow the historical cost concept. So now, when the new partner comes, he will also have an equivalent share in the 10 lakh, wherein he would not have contributed anything towards the purchase of the building. For this reason, what is to be done is, so we need to revalue these buildings. As I told you, let us assume that now today the building is worth 15 lakh rupees. So the difference, there is a hike in the price of 5 lakhs. This 5 lakhs, the benefit of this 5 lakhs, the difference money, should go to the old partners. So when it is being given to the old partners, then naturally the building is shown at 15 lakhs as on today's value, where this 15 lakhs will be distributed among all the partners, including the upcoming new partner. So revaluation of both assets and liabilities is a must and a requirement before we admit a new partner. So hope you would have understood the significance in the preparation of revaluation account. So the question arises, why a revaluation account has to be prepared? For which I have explained you the criteria behind its preparation. Now let us understand as to how it needs to be prepared. This revaluation account mainly comprises of the difference in the value of both assets and liabilities. Could it be an increase or decrease in the value of any asset or liability would be recorded into this revaluation account. And remember, the difference or the balance of this revaluation account will be posted to the personal accounts of the old partners in the old profit sharing ratio. So always the old partners are entitled to the difference, whether it is profit on revaluation or loss on revaluation. Who is entitled to receive this profit or loss on revaluation benefit? It would go to the old partners should it be shared in the old profit sharing ratio. Now, revaluation account is prepared on the principle of nominal account. So, what is the principle under nominal account? Debit all expenses and losses, credit all incomes and gains. Like how we prepare revenue account, nominal account, we need to prepare the revaluation account on the principles of a nominal account. Now, any increase in the asset, the buildings were worth 10 lakhs and now it is worth 15 lakhs. A common sense question, should it benefit the partners or it is going to give a loss to the partners? It will definitely be a benefit. So, increase in the asset is a benefit. Similarly, decrease in the liability is also a benefit to the old partners. Liability indicates what you need to pay to the outsiders. Your debt of payment to the outsider is indicated through a liability. If the liability decreases, it is a benefit to the old partners. So, both increase in the asset and decrease in liability marks a benefit side. That is, it is considered as a gain to the old partners. And so, these two aspects are to be credited to revaluation account because the nominal account principle says as credit all incomes and gains. Coming to unrecorded asset, what exactly is an unrecorded asset? Sometimes by chance or by oversight, any asset which has been purchased into the business would not have been recorded into the books of the accounts. So now what happens when you are accounting for both assets and liabilities freshly? Suddenly you realize that there is an asset which has not been recorded in your earlier books of accounts. So once you realize that, meaning that once you want to take that into the books of the accounts, this will be titled as unrecorded asset. And unrecorded asset also is a gain because so far you have never even, you have not known that such an asset exists in your business. Suddenly you discover, oh yeah, there is an asset which needs to be taken into the books of accounts. So this also will be credited to your revaluation account. So what are the items that needs to be credited to your revaluation account? Three important items: increase in the assets value, only the difference, that is the increase amount only will be taken to the credit, the actuals will not be taken. So the difference, increase in the asset, similarly the decrease in the liability, and if any unrecorded asset comes into notice, these three items will be credited to your revaluation account. Similarly, the opposite of this effect will be to the debit of revaluation. If there is a decrease in the asset, might it be the depreciation on any asset or could it be increase in liability? Your creditors are going to ask you more interest or suddenly some outstanding expense is created that you realize that you have to pay some electricity bill which was pending. So here, such kinds of increase in liability and simultaneously any unrecorded liability being suddenly discovered will be debited to revaluation account. So revaluation account is a nominal account and it needs to be balanced. The difference in this revaluation account will be titled as profit on revaluation or loss on revaluation. Either way, it needs to be distributed among the old partners in the old ratio. Now, on your slide is given the format of revaluation account. I have explained you the various items that needs to be entered into revaluation account. you yourself can make a note of what are the values that needs to be recorded, what are the items that needs to be recorded and on which side. Let us begin with the debit side. The debit side, we have decrease in the value of asset. Asset could be plant, machinery, stock. Could it be a fixed asset or a current asset? Similarly, increase in the value of any liability, maybe creditors, bills payable. If they are asking for more interest or if they are asking for more payments, that will be debited. And come to the credit side now. Increase in the value of assets. We call it as appreciation. Could it be appreciation on fixed or current assets? And by decrease in the value of liability. Supposing creditors are ready to give away their claims, we are cancelling their claims. Bills payable is getting discounted or they are asking for the less payment from us. So this will be a benefit to the firm and needs to be credited. Now after entering these items, you need to balance the ledger accounts. Supposing the credit side total is more than that of debit side, the difference will be put on the debit side. As I told you, the difference money has to be transferred to the capital accounts of the old partners in their old ratio. Similarly, if the debit side is more, it represents loss on revaluation. And in the case of loss, it will be shown on the credit side, opposite side, because credit side totals will be less. And the same entry would it be there by capital accounts of the old partners, wherein the loss will be shared in the old profit sharing ratio. Now you need to learn the journal entries in respect to the recording of, say, the changes in the value of assets and liabilities on account of revaluation. Children, it is very easy to remember the journal entries. You just have to recollect your revaluation account details. Which side are we entering? On the debit side, what are we taking into the revaluation and on the credit side? So based on this, you will have to frame the journal entries logically. Okay. So for increase in the asset, tell me on which side of the revaluation should it be shown? The increase in the asset? Yes. You need to show it on the credit side. So the journal entry will be assets account debit to revaluation account. Whatever you take on the credit side of the revaluation while drafting the journal entry, you will have to compulsorily say to revaluation account. So that is the easy way to remember your journal entries. That is why I put first the preparation of the ledger accounts and then came back to the journal entries. So that drafting of the journal entries will have a logical sequence in your mind. Do not memorize, do not by heart these journal entries. They won't rest in your mind for a longer time. You need to have that mind mapping of how to draft the journal entries based on the ledger account. Now for decrease in the asset, it will be opposite. Rightly said, revaluation account debit to asset account. Because you are going to debit revaluation account, here you are going to draft the entry as revaluation account debtor to asset account, being decrease in the value of the assets. Vice versa for increase in liability. Which side you are going to post the increase in liability into revaluation? On the debit side. So the journal entry would be revaluation account debit to concerned liabilities account. For decrease in liability, it would be concerned liabilities account debit to revaluation account. Journal entries will be definitely asked for theory questions, and it is compulsory that you draft a journal entry and write the narration also. The respective narrations command half of the marks. So necessarily both the journal entry has to be written properly along with the necessary narration. Now coming to unrecorded assets and liabilities. As I told you, the meaning of unrecorded assets, in case if the asset value has not been posted to the books of the accounts into the previous balance sheet, now it becomes mandatory because you are like, you know, digging up what assets are there, liabilities are there, you are revaluing at the time of admitting the partner. So in such a case, what happens is when any asset is found not being recorded in the previous balance sheet, it is mandatory to record it right now. In such a case, On which side should it be taken? The unrecorded asset value has to be taken to the credit of revaluation because it marks a gain to the partnership firm. So the entry would be unrecorded asset account debtor to revaluation account being unrecorded assets recorded. When it comes to liability, unrecorded liability, it will be vice versa. Revaluation account debit to unrecorded liability account. Well, the closing of the revaluation account is done by transferring the balance to the old partner's capital account in their old ratio. So, if the credit is more, the difference money will be put on the debit side. If the debit balance, debit total is more, the difference money will be cast on the credit side. So, how do you close the revaluation account? By posting the difference money, which marks as profit on revaluation or loss on revaluation, it will be posted to the personal accounts of the old partners in their profit sharing ratio. Assuming that we get profit. What does profit indicate? The credit total is more than that of debit. So, which side are you going to post the balance money? You are going to post it on the debit side. So, the entry would be revaluation account debit to old partners capital account. So, here the profit on the revaluation is transferred to the old partners in their old profit sharing ratio. And in case of loss that you sustain, the entry would be old partners capital account debit to revaluation account being loss on revaluation transferred. So this is how we close the revaluation account balance. So I hope this lecture was purposeful. Listen to the lecture repeatedly. Pause it whenever you have any confusion. Sorry. Or when you have to get any clarification, you can pause it for a while and you can listen to it once again so that you are able to understand all the aspects thoroughly. So we will come up with more details upon the admission of a partner, the accounting treatment in respect to admission of the partner in the forthcoming lectures, and work on all the examples that have been discussed so far. So thank you, students. Have a very, very good day and have a cheerful life ahead. Thank you.